afternoon, everyone. Welcome back to our last session, titled At Home in the World. And we have a wonderful panel lineup to end today's session. Angelica Freitas, Eka Kurniawan, Kyoko Yoshida, Vivek Shanbhag, and Yassmin Abdel-Magied, in conversation with Helena Kennedy and introduced by the wonderful Sunil Buch. Sunil, if you'd like to join us, please. And I must say, presented by Zindagi. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Are you working? Are you guys able to hear? Okay, good evening once again, everyone. It's a pleasure for me to be here to introduce this beautiful session coming up for all of us. At Home in the World is a session about the resonance of poetry and shared stories across the borders of languages and culture. And none other than the eminent speakers whom we have with us this evening can do justice to this topic. We have Angelica Freitas, author of A Uterus is the Size of a Fist and Rilke Shake. Her work has appeared in Poetry, Grantor Magazine, and Modern Poetry in Translation. We have Eka Kurniawan, author of novels, short stories, originally written in Bahasa. His work has been translated in several international languages like Dutch, French, German, Italian, Japanese, Korean, and Malay. We have Kyoko Yoshida. She writes fiction in Japanese and translates both ways, from Japanese to English and English to Japanese. Her latest work appears in Gozo Yoshimasu's Alice Iris Red Horse. Vivek Shanbhag writes in Kannada, has published short stories, novels, and plays. His acclaimed novel, Gacha Gochar, is also published in English. And we have Yassmin Abdel-Magied, who advocates for the empowerment of youth, women, and those from culturally and linguistically diverse backgrounds. She also has founded a not-for-profit organization called Youth Without Borders. Okay, the reason why I'm introducing this session is not because we are title sponsors as Z, but there's a genuine goodness of fit between this session and one of the TV channels that we run. I'll just kind of play a small AV for you to kind of have a look at it. Can you have the AV, please?
For the first time on Indian television, beautiful stories from faraway land. Strong characters. Riveting dramas. Blockbuster stories from across the world. Only on Zindagi.
So while At Home in the World is a theme today, I think the world has been at home for us at Zindagi. We genuinely believe that the language of emotions is universal. Be it love, be it anger, be it joy. You feel the same in Turkey, in Peru, in Korea, and that's what we've been trying to show this to the people of India for the last 3.5 years. It's been very well received, and there's craving for more. Are you okay? And lastly, finally, life is a journey of moments. And I think it's very critical that we leave each one of them and not do rewind play and you know, kind of live in the past and, you know, analyze stuff. Because in the bargain, we lose today and more importantly, tomorrow. So let's seize the moment today and listen to the beautiful speakers that we have today. And I would want to now, on that note, request Helena Kennedy, who's a recipient of 42 honorary awards and someone who chairs the Booker Prize Foundation too, to take the session forward. Thank you. Cheers.
Can everyone hear me? Well, if anything is a celebration of the way in which writing of poetry and of novels and plays and of screenplays, the ways in which the world talks from one nation to the other, it's this festival. Because we do see that in every one of the sessions that we hold here in Jaipur. We're certainly crossing borders. And as Sunil has said, it really is One of the ways in which we understand our common humanity is to read what is written by the other, read what is written by someone who comes from a different place, and understand their emotions are the same as ours. And so I wanted us to start by just talking about some of the ways in which we do that. I was going to start with you, Kyoko, because you are someone who doesn't write in your own language. You write in English when you're doing your own creative writing.
Right.
And so I wanted to ask you, I mean, do you think in English when you're doing it?
I used to translate from Japanese into English, but nowadays when I write stories in English, because it's so bonded in the language and images that it comes from words, so it starts in English. Yeah.
So you start in English, but is Japanese running alongside it on a track just alongside?
Definitely. Yeah. Something I do sometimes is that, well, you know, poetic language is to resurrect metaphors, dead metaphors. That's what you do to kind of, you know, rewrite cliches. I often use, for instance, Japanese cliche directly translated into English, which sometimes makes sense, but it sounds new in English language. That's one of the things, for instance.
Yeah. Eka, you have you've been very successful in your writing recently, and you were on that list for the Man Booker Prize, and your book was really celebrated internationally. So you've been translated, and you certainly have crossed borders. But the language that you write in is your own language. I mean, you're Indonesian, and you write in Indonesian, but you also have created new words, new sounds to have meaning. You've been inventive with the language that you use. How do you do that? Why did it happen?
Because Indonesian actually my second language. Because in Indonesia, almost everybody has their own local language. For example, I myself is Sundanese. Sometimes I speak in Japanese too. But because Indonesian is a national language and everybody write in Indonesian, so I write in Indonesian. I learn Indonesian at school, but Indonesian itself is kind of a new language, actually based on from Malay, and we learn it especially in school. And then when I have moved to, for example, to Yogyakarta, is a big city where people come from around archipelago, so we have to speak in Indonesian, because if we speak in our own local language, we don't understand each other. But this new language is sometimes I feel is very simple. So when I need something that, for example, there is no words for one kind of expression, sometimes I borrow it from Sundanese, from Japanese. It's something happen, because sometimes I just take the dictionary, Sundanese dictionary, to find out what is how to express this kind of first feeling, because sometimes in Indonesian the feeling is so simple. It have no nuance, for example. So sometimes I borrow it. I make up new words for it.
So you make up new words, you borrow from the different languages of the archipelago that you live in, and you also, of course, write in Indonesian. Does it create a problem for your translators that you're writing across these different languages?
Yeah, of course. Sometimes it's make a problem with the translator, but I think it's the good thing that we can speak. I speak with the translator. Sometimes we try to solve the problem. For example, the title of my second novel is in Indonesian, it's Laki Harimau. It's actually not a familiar term in Indonesia. Usually we call manusia harimau. Manusia is actually man, and harimau is tiger. But I don't want to set it manusia harimau, because it feel like like a superhero, you know, like
like man tiger.
Yeah. So I use lelaki is a kind of male, lelaki harimau. But when it being translated into English, so we facing the same problem. It used to be translated as Tiger Man. But we don't want that. so it's and the editor proposed this poetic solution to change the structure, so it's being Man Tiger.
I should tell everyone that your latest novel, Man Tiger, is about a young man who commits a crime and who says it was the tiger in him that did it, that he is possessed by a tiger. And I've represented many clients who've said that the devil made them do what they did, but I haven't ever had anybody say that it was a tiger that made them do what they did. But perhaps you could read a little bit in the language, because I think it's important for people to hear the musicality of the languages in which people write.
I will read one paragraph from my novel, The Man Tiger, but it's written in Indonesian, so I will read it in Indonesian so you can hear the sound of my language. Saat itulah Masoma keluar dari surau dan melihatnya merayap dengan tangan berkelepotan darah. Ia hampir berlari mengejarnya. Cemas namun segera tertegun, melihat tanda jejak yang menggumpal sepanjang pekaraman, menuju rumah Anwar Sadat. Ia melihat genangan yang melimpah di ambang pintu, dan kakinya memaksa dia membawa ke sana, melihat mayat yang hikmat menunggu. Ada kekosongan yang tadi mengerti kepalanya, sebelum suara bisikan menjelaskan segalanya. Memapah Maisa Dewi ke sofa dan mengambil kain batik untuk menenggelamkan mayat Anwar Sadat. Seseorang yang lain di tepi lapangan bola melihat Margio dan bergumam, "Demi Tuhan, Margio dipukul orang hingga berdarah."
Eka, you have had your book now translated into many different languages, and you've traveled to promote your book and to talk to audiences about the book. Do different audiences from different cultures receive your book in a different way?
Yeah, it used to be, for example, in Indonesia, when they read the Man Tiger, they didn't, for example, they didn't ask me about the supernatural thing, about the mythology, about the tiger inside the body of a boys. But usually, they ask me about the violence in his household, about the role of men and women in family, something like that. But when the books are translated into other languages, they talk about, they ask me about the political metaphoric about the novel and the Indonesian situations, about the mythology and something like that.
That's very interesting. That's very interesting that that different peoples, because of their own experience and their own connection to the spiritual or to the psychological, will approach a novel like yours in a different way. Angelica, you're a poet.
Yes.
And your poetry has been translated, and translating poetry is accepted as being a particularly difficult thing. Do you collaborate very closely with those who translate your work?
I do. Yeah. I'm a translator myself. I prefer not to translate poetry, actually. But my first book has been translated into English and German. And I had to work very closely with the translators, even though they are proficient in Portuguese. And they asked me a zillion questions. I thought, well, when are we going to be over with these questions? But they kept coming. And for me, it was really interesting to to see what kind of things they didn't understand. And for me, I thought they were really clear, but yeah. So you really have to work very closely with your translator, even though they're fluent in the language.
I should tell you all that Angelica's first book of poetry was called, that was certainly was translated into English, was called A Uterus is the Size of a Fist. A feminist book of poetry?
Of course.
How did we know? And perhaps you would read a little of your poetry for us in the Portuguese, again,
I would love
so we
to.
Might hear it.
Sure. Right. This one is from A Uterus is the Size of a Fist. It goes like this. Porque uma mulher boa é uma mulher limpa. E se ela é uma mulher limpa, ela é uma mulher boa. Há milhões e milhões de anos pôs-se sobre duas patas. A mulher era braba e suja e ladrava. Porque uma mulher braba não é uma mulher boa. E uma mulher boa é uma mulher limpa. Há milhões e milhões de anos pôs-se sobre duas patas. Não ladra mais, é mansa e boa e limpa.
Would you like to know what this poem is about?
Yeah,
okay,
so
it's something like this. Because a good woman is a clean woman, and if she's a clean woman, she's a good woman. Millions, millions of years ago, she stood up on her own 2 feet. Woman was angry and dirty and barking, because an angry woman is not a good woman, and a good woman is a clean woman. Millions, millions of years ago, she stood up on her own 2 feet. She doesn't bark anymore. She's meek. She's meek and good and clean.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
It's a delicious book of poems. I mean, it really is wonderful. And that sort of thing of the ways in which we stereotype the good woman is exactly what you're engaging with. Vivek, you write in a language that's called Kannada, spelled with a K. And it's a street language. Sort of, no? Explain to me.
It is a language which has a literary tradition of over 1,000 years. It is one of the South Indian languages and has a very rich literature.
I'd love to hear it. Can we hear a bit of it from you?
Yeah. I'm reading the first passage from the book Gachar Gochar. It is a novel. It's also published in English translation. Vincent coffee house nalli waiter agiddane. Adara hesaru coffee house ashte. 100 varshagalashtu haleya hesaru badalagadiddaru vyavahara badalagide. Iga adondu bar and restaurant. Adare olleya coffee kuda doriyuva bar and restaurant. Manda belakinalli ಇಕ್ಕಟ್ಟು ಟೇಬಲ್ಗಳಲ್ಲಿ ಕಿಕ್ಕಿರದ ಜನರಿಗೆ ತಾವೇನೋ ತಪ್ಪು ಮಾಡುತ್ತಿದ್ದೇವೆ ಎಂದೆನಿಸುವಂತೆ ಕುಡಿತ ಪೂರೈಸುವ ಜಾಗ ಇದಲ್ಲ. ಭರಪೂರ ಗಾಳಿ ಬೆಳಕಿನ ಎತ್ತರದ ಛಾವಣಿಯ ಮೋಜಿನ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಪಾಪ ಪ್ರಜ್ಞೆ ಹುಟ್ಟಿಸಿದ ಕುಡಿತವನ್ನು ಅತ್ಯಂತ ಸಂಭ್ರಮ ಸಂಭ್ರಮದ ಚಟುವಟಿಕೆ ಎನಿಸುವಂತೆ ಮಾಡುವ ಜಾಗ.
It was Vivek who had the idea that he would like you to hear what this sounds like, because the speed of it and the rhythms in it in the language are so interesting. Now you've written novels, plays, short stories, and meant much translation of your work. Have your translators worked very closely with you in trying to capture that resonance?
Yes. In my case, it is. I don't know whether it's a strange case, but I think most of the Indians grow up with multiple languages. So my mother tongue is Konkani. I write in Kannada and translated into English. So there is a certain kind of Konkani sensibility also one can see in my writing. And when I say that, it is, I can give an example, which is, you know, in my childhood, we used to hear this. If you ask someone for the directions, and if you say how far is that destination or where a temple is or wherever you are going, and then they would use a word, yeah. And the, actually the meaning of that word, it was called Fothbar, the meaning of the word is, it is the time taken for someone to take a puff of a bidi, to inhale and exhale, right? So it's a, such a wonderful way of expressing. So what I mean is this kind of sensibilities of from one language, one brings into the other language that, that you write in. So that is natural to me because I live in these languages, you know, without my knowledge. I mean, if I'm aware of it, then probably I don't think I can write. Now, coming back to your question of translation, yes, I do work with translators very closely. And it is important because there are many things that a writer takes for granted when one writes in a language. And when it goes into the other language, a lot of things don't work. So one has to be really aware, like the examples that Angelina was giving, you know, the hundreds of queries, they do come. But then the my the discussion that I have had, most of the discussions that I have had with my translator is not about the meaning or, you know, the meaning of a word or a sentence, but more about my intention, more about the secrets of a writer, you know, why a particular word was used and reused or used multiple times, and why a certain situation has been juxtaposed with something else. So I think it is important to understand this so that you can, you know, bring this unsaid from one language into the other.
For that reason, have you developed a relationship with a particular translator who really does understand what where you're coming from, what your intention is, and what drives your choices in language?
Yeah, I think, I do have a strong relationship with the person. His name is Srinath Perur. He has done one translation, he's on to the other. I think more and more we go further in it, we entrench ourselves more deeply into this, right? But I think it is necessary, I feel.
I mean, one of the things that I chair the Man Booker Foundation, the foundation that basically runs the prize. And we now have an international translation prize, an international Man Booker Prize. And the, half the prize goes to the writer and half the prize goes to the translator. And we really believed that that was the way to go because we really want to encourage translation to do that crossing of borders, to do that reaching across cultures, for us to read more what is written in the languages of other people. And we're seeing a shrinking of the opportunities for that because of the drive in the publishing world, I think, the pressures are on to sell widely and on around money. So we really wanted to encourage translation. So it seemed to me that when we come across books that are wonderfully translated, it's usually because there is that proximity between the writer and the translator. Now I wanted to ask, thank you Vivek, I wanted to ask you, Yassmin Abdel-Magied is a very interesting woman. I'm going to tell you about her because she's not just a writer. In fact, she's abandoning her other life in order to give herself wholly to writing, but she's actually an oil engineer, an engineer in the oil world. She's what's called a petrol head. And so she works in the oil business, but that's not enough for her. The real passion is writing, and she's been writing since she was very young, and she's still very young. And she founded something called Youth Without Borders. And your writing is largely, I think, Yassmin, about that alchemy of gender and race. You, although your family were Sudanese, and you fled and went to settle in Australia, when you were still a very tiny child, and you're an Australian, really. An Australian, though, with a very interesting heritage and speak two languages. What do you write in?
So I write in English, and I once attempted to write in Arabic, and everyone in my family was like, no, please, never again, because that makes no sense. And I think it's actually something that I'm quite sad about in a way, that because I think Arabic is such a rich language and a language that has so much history, and my faith is connected to it as well. Like, I'm Muslim, so the Quran is in Arabic. And I wish that I could understand the Quran as I read it in Arabic and not have to have the translation, because I think some things, some essences are about the language as much as they are the words. And so maybe, you know, because I did grow up speaking it in the home, hopefully maybe one day with enough practice I'll be able to write in Arabic as well as I do in English, but we'll see.
Have you yet been translated?
No.
So here's a woman who's looking for a translator.
It is fascinating because when you talk about audience, a lot of what I talk about, or a lot of what I write about is relevant to a Arab-speaking audience. And they constantly are the ones that are asking for the translation more so than me wanting. But it's a case of, you know, although culturally we're very similar, the language in which we speak and thus the way that we're thinking about issues is different.
Do you get criticism? We're talking about crossing cultures, and you're a woman who lives across cultures. Are you critiqued by your own community in Australia? You know, the Sudanese community. Do they like what you write? How do they take it?
It's a funny sort of a relationship, I think, when you are somebody from a marginalized group who sort of goes out and speaks in the public space, speaks in my situation, a young Muslim woman of color speaking in a Western context, because everything you say becomes not only owned by you, but owned by the entire community. And so when I say things that the community is happy with, and the community could be any number of people, right? It's just sort of this broad range of people that see themselves as part of my community. When they approve of what I say, they're very happy to take ownership of me. But it is a very, very fragile type of approval, because at any given moment, and there've been a number of times in the past year where I've said something that perhaps is a little controversial or isn't quite, you know, what a good girl or a good Muslim girl or a good Sudanese girl would say or do. And then all of a sudden, you know, you become someone that is worthy of vitriol. And that's, I think there is nothing... You know, Muslim women in particular, I think, face two battles. One externally, in the Western context, where people are sort of saying, well, you're oppressed and we need to save you and we don't like Muslims, et cetera, et cetera. But also within our own communities and our own families. And there's nothing more exhausting than fighting your own family for your own voice.
Yeah. I wanted to ask Kyoko, have you had any of those struggles? I mean, you are a very accomplished translator, and you translate works in Japanese into English. And I just wanted to know about the closeness of the proximity you have with those whom you translate, and what works best as a translator. And then I wanted to ask you about your own work in English, whether that's criticized as being an abandonment of your own tongue. So two questions, basically.
Well, in translation theory, you're supposed to translate from second language to first language. So I'm translating against the theory. I translate both ways, but when I'm translating from Japanese to English, that's something you're not really supposed to do. But I'm doing it for purely selfish reasons. Because I write in English, I want to improve my skills or hone, you know, so when I translate from Japanese to English, I translate only experimental contemporary Japanese poetry, which is really, really difficult to translate. It's difficult to read even in Japanese, and everybody knows you cannot recreate the same thing in another language. So from the beginning, it's the impossible puzzle. And I like the idea of you just sit and concentrate and work on the puzzle. And that's the way for me to work on my skills in writing. And another thing is I work with contemporary poets, meaning I can work with them closely, but at the same time, I don't ask too many questions. One thing I like about working with experimental poets, they know what's going to happen when their work is translated. It's going to become something slightly different. And they trust me often. They like to see what's going to happen when it's translated. It's like mirror image, but slightly different. And I feel like I'm part of this collaborative work. And that's something really wonderful about that. And when I write in English, people ask me, why do you write in English? I mean, in Japan, people don't read in English much. So now I live and work in Japan, writing in English is like, there's nobody who would read my stuff. And why do you write in English? And I always say my first answer, and it's just a brief answer, is that because my mother cannot read it. So in a way, it's a way of getting away from the trouble that you have to face. But, well, this is also, you know, joke and a brief answer, and there's a longer answer to it. But but I think recently I started to feel like I'm, you know, when you write in English, people think like I'm selling out. I'm writing in this global major language. But, you know, it's not like now everybody in the world is going to read my story. So for me, writing in English is almost like making English something minor, you know, less important. And I kind of like that idea.
I was interested in the idea that you make the joke that you're writing to, you know, so your mother can't read it. But is it part of a sort of distancing that allows you to explore things that perhaps in your own language would be too intimate, that you can explore yes. intimacy in another language perhaps even more than you can in your own? Is that possible?
Definitely. I always wanted to write, and when I started to write in Japanese when I was, I don't know, little, you know, I had certain ideas about literary language. And you would start writing in this really, you know, bad, flowery language. But when I write in English, because my, you know, I didn't grow up in English, that certainly there's this distance and, like, you know, that you are playing with this strange material.
So it's a new material, uh-huh. in a way that you're not constrained by what's considered the proprieties of language. I'm sorry if you haven't been able to hear, but so you don't feel so constrained by mm-hmm. what is considered good Japanese.
Right, exactly. And also, I feel like I don't have to write about something important. I just write trivial things, and just I'm glad I could put it down in, you know, whatever expression.
Do you feel liberated, Ika? By creating new language, by including in your writing not just Indonesian but all the different languages of your archipelago, of your nation, and like words that you create yourself, is that a liberation, a freedom from constraints that you would have in speaking the official language?
Yeah, of course. I think Indonesian language give me such kind of freedoms. Then I use it. I use it with happiness, of course. But sometimes it make a kind of trouble between Indonesian readers too, because sometimes they didn't understand what this kind of words in your novel. For example, there is one particular words I put in my novel. It's called ajak. Ajak is actually. It's Sudanese, Japanese understand too. It's a kind of wild dog in the jungle.
A wild dog?
Wild dog. Sometimes my editor said to me, you can just put the wild dog in your novel. No, I just want to put the ajak because it's not really wild dog. It's different from what the Indonesian think about wild dog. In Sundanese we have another word for wild dog. I just want to put this special dog in my novel, so I just put that ajak. The word is survived in English translation, even because English translation have no words about that too.
It's such a specific wild dog. We yeah. don't have one.
Yeah. Okay. And then sometimes there is a reader who, sometimes if the reader is Sundanese. But if he or she live in the in the urban area, he didn't familiar with the wild dog or anything. It is, what kind of idea? You just find out in Google, I said. And then they just find out, and it already there, actually. You can find in Wikipedia, in Google, but sometimes people didn't understand what it mean and what it's about. So I think it's liberating me, but at the same time, it's make a kind of open possibility for not, it's not only word. It's word always represented about culture, about something, about even about the space, yes.
Angelica, does your mother read your poetry?
Yeah, she used to, and she loved it, actually, so I considered myself lucky.
Good.
She approved of it, yeah.
Many poets describe the business of actually really reaching for the very perfect word and for the tightness, that you're, the constraints of poetry, that in itself, and in many ways, although hard, is actually, can liberate very free expression. Do you feel that? Do you feel that poetry is the best way for you to give expression to your ideas?
I certainly do. And I feel that so many things are happening in the world right now, and in my country also. And I feel I have to write about these things. I mean, if I don't write about them, what am I going to write about? And because you have social media and you can publish things instantly, I feel that maybe the search for the perfect word or the perfect way to see it is secondary now. I mean, the important thing now is just really to get your poems, your ideas across, and maybe coming back to the poems and working on them later. But since we have the opportunity to just let the poems out in the world, I think it's we should really do it. And it's really difficult to write about the things that are going on in the world now. But I think it's our job as writers and poets to do it.
I'm gonna, Vivek, I want to ask you about this, because you've chosen to do something different. I mean, you speak a number of languages, a number of Indian languages, you speak English incredibly well, and you write in Canada. That is your language for your creativity. And why did you make that choice? Because it is a choice.
See, it is a language in which I studied. And for me, more importantly, it is a language of the street. When I say language of the street, it means the life that I lead, the people around me, the people, you know, the folk is in this language. There is a rich tradition which is in this language. And for a writer, I think when you write, at least I'll talk for myself, when I write, I try to touch something deep within me. And it has to happen in a language which is, many times it is beyond me. It's like, you know, when you create a poem, a word generates, you know, creates the next word, and a sentence, the next sentence. And many times I'm surprised with what appears on the page. And if I have to get that experience, it can only happen with a language with which I have very deep and intense connection. The connection which I cannot articulate fully. And that language for me is Kannada. That is the reason why I even chose to go for a translator and not translate my own work. Because I want a translator who can have this kind of connection with English. If he can't have that relationship with English, then I don't think he can bring that unsaid from my work into English. That's very important for me.
That's really interesting. So is your translator, is his or her first language English?
Yes.
I see, and so they've learned Kannada another language.
He speaks Kannada at home, but his relationship with English is as mine is with Kannada.
Oh, that's very interesting. I want to ask you, Yassmin, about writing. Because I suggested you were dealing with difficult stuff, and particularly as a Muslim woman living in the West. Explain to us what it is that crosses the line for the sensibilities of many in your family, and also where you find that it reaches to people, to the common experience, that it makes, it crosses the bridge?
Yeah, it's a fascinating question, I guess, to think about what does make people uncomfortable or upset. And I think a lot of it comes back to the concept of airing dirty laundry. So people, you know, within the Muslim community in Australia, for example, within the Sudanese community in Australia, it's very difficult for someone from that community to go out into the world or out into, say, mainstream Australia and talk about issues within the culture, whether it be around patriarchal culture and whether it be around what women can and can't do or the way that, or any sort of internal issues, whether it's corruption, whether it's anything, because it's because there is so much, I guess, attention. External. Yeah, because there is already so much external sort of pressure, it's as if you are legitimizing it. It's as if, you know, if I go out and say, hey, actually, yeah, the guys in the Muslim community in Australia are really, you know, harsh to their wives, or there are cases of abuse and so on. All it gives is ammunition for people outside the community to say, hey, we were right all along. You guys really are oppressed, et cetera, et cetera. And it doesn't allow for nuance. It doesn't allow for me to have a conversation about improving the culture without or improving the society or the community within without it seeming like I am selling out or I'm kind of, you know, going on the side of the people who, you know, we're trying to, who are also attacking or oppressing in some way. I think it's a challenge, right? Because there are, within the Muslim community in Australia, and that's all I can speak to, it's not perfect, right? But if I go out and say within the Muslim community in Australia it's not perfect, people will be like, well, you know, why are you saying this outside? Why can't you say that inside the community? But I don't necessarily have the platform within the community, or maybe within the community I'm not being heard, and the only way I can be heard is if I go outside. So it's this kind of almost a whistleblowing mentality. But who, as somebody said to me, why are you showing loyalty when that's a challenge to potentially your integrity? Like, who are you showing loyalty to? But the reality is that for young Muslim women, for example, and I can only speak to that particular experience in Australia. We go out into the world, we go out into our world and our community, and we're constantly being asked to justify our existence. We're constantly being asked to defend, you know, to people constantly ask, why do you do this? Or why are you part of this religion? Or why are you part of this culture? Why can't you just be like us? And it doesn't allow for a multiplicity of identities because of, I guess, what we see in the global political context. And so when I go out and write, I feel all of these realities on my shoulders, whether rightly or wrongly. I feel like I do, on one hand, have to represent in some way. I have to be positive in some way, because if I don't, does that reflect badly on my community? Am I legitimizing something that's already out there? And also, the reason why I started writing is because, as I write in the beginning of my book, there are almost no voices of young Muslim women telling their own stories, particularly in the West. Like, yeah, we're invisible.
I just wanted to pick up on that, because we are really talking about the sharing of ideas, the business of storytelling, being a way of giving expression to our to our own realities of the pain we feel, the love we feel, the ways in which we feel humiliation and so on. All those things which people around the world, wherever they're from, know this stuff. And I just want to know, has anything ever surprised you when you've gone in front of an audience? Has anything ever surprised you where you've said, that didn't cross borders. That failed to make the transition. Have you ever had a question or something coming from an audience where you said, "Oh, they really don't understand what this is like"? Have you ever had that experience, or have people always been able to make the leap with you?
Yeah, sometimes I'm being surprised by the response from readers outside Indonesia. Because sometimes, to be honest, I wrote the novel exactly for a little close friend, so it's not intentionally to be get to read by the whole world. So no, here and there sometimes it's only understand by the close friend of mine. So when it was being translated into, for example, to English and read in American and UK, and sometimes they respond in a different way. For example, they sometimes ask about the violence, about the sexual openness in my novels, and they have their own idea about Indonesia, for example, as a Muslim country. Do you have no problem with the sexual in your novel in your country? And I said no, because I don't know. Maybe it's just they know it's written by Indonesians, and they know what kind of writers I am. So they didn't think it's something surprising, but it's become something surprising for people outside Indonesia, and I'm being surprised too about that.
They're surprised that you actually have a sex life at all. But what about you? What has surprised any of you? Who would like to come in?
I mean, I think one of the biggest difference I find is when I talk to a Western audience versus broadly an Eastern one, and try to translate the communal versus individualistic ways of thinking, right? Whereas in Sudan, giving things up for your family or giving things up for your community is like unquestioned. Of course you would give up your career to take care of your mother. Whereas that in Australia, for example, people think that's ludicrous because there are different ideas of responsibility and obligation and the family unit. So that's been something that I found really interesting to translate. If I ever wrote about anything vaguely to do with anything sexual, I would be like, you know, I would definitely be one of the not good women, and like my family would disown me, my community would disown me. We had one of my good friends, a Lebanese woman who was like heralded within the community, once decided to say that she supported the rights of LGBTQI Muslims and was essentially disowned by everyone she knew. She moved countries. And this is in the Muslim community in Australia. So I have Western friends who are like, well, you should be able to write whatever you want. Like, you shouldn't worry about what people will say. But the reality is what people will say has an impact on the effectiveness we can have in our advocacy. So,
Vivek.
Yeah, I have not come across major surprises, but I'll give one example. There is a scene in my novel where a woman sits on the floor and cooks. It was very difficult for people to visualize this. Right, that so we had to be a little more explicit to explain that she actually is sitting on the floor and cook. There were many such things, but nothing like what I explained.
Yes, yes. And how about you, Kyoko?
Well, I started to write in the workshop environment of creative writing program in America, and my classmates, mostly, you know, white Americans, are very careful to read my text. They worry, like, if they misread some of the cultural background, you know, Japanese cultural background of whatever I write. And that I feel like, well, you don't have to worry about it. You know, that the read it whatever way you want. You know, the reader owns the text. But I found it interesting that they want to make my text oriental. So I was like, well, I'm going to provide fake information about the East. So hence my book, the collection of short stories, is titled Disorientalism. You know, I provide whatever fake Oriental images that people would like. It's so fake that unless you're really clueless, you won't read it as a realist fiction. But sometimes people come up to me and say, like, but that's exactly how I felt when I was in Beijing. But that story has like a killer panda bears in it.
Well, that's really, I love that, Disorientalism. You'll have to look for that book, which Kyoko has just written, a book of short stories. Over to you now, Angelica. What has taken you by surprise when you've gone and done your poetry readings in other countries? And I mean, your English is wonderful. So, I mean, you know, have you been taken by surprise or not?
I have, and maybe this has to do with the people who usually come to poetry readings, at least in Brazil and the countries I've been to. They're generally people who read poetry or poets. But I was invited to read in Romania a few years ago, and I read, so I sent them some poems. They asked me to send them poems that I really liked, the ones I've written. So I sent them a poem about Gertrude Stein. It was translated into Romanian. But they took us to read in a rural community. And so I had to read this Gertrude Stein poem to people who, you know, had no idea who she was and were not used to listening to poetry at all. But they were very polite and they listened to it and they clapped their hands at the end of of my reading. But I just knew they had no idea what I was going on about. Very humbling experience.
We've all had those experiences, even in other contexts. But I want to just be, we haven't given you enough time to talk about poetry and we're just coming to an end. But do poets, when you meet with poets from across the world, do you feel immediately a sort of sympathetic connection because you've struggled with the business of putting deep emotions into language?
Sure, I think we're a tribe.
Yeah. Yeah. Now, I'm being given signs, I think, that we're coming to a close. I can't see anybody out there, you see, so I can't see hands or anything. But has anybody got a question? There's somebody there. Please, would you like to come in with your question?
Yeah, hi, good evening, everyone. I wanted to know one thing, that you all are from different cultures and different countries, and your work has been translated in from one language to another. Now, this one thing is called lost in translation. So what, I mean, I know that you cannot translate the actual essence of one language to another, but what work has been done in that area where we can actually try and bring that kind of essence, not 100%, probably 70 to 80% to the another language?
Any other hand, and I'll take a couple of questions if there's anyone else. Is someone there, please? And a gentleman there. So the gentleman and then the young woman there, please.
Thank you so much. My query is to Kyoko. In terms of your understanding of the anxiety of your American colleagues to be understood correctly, but is your response has to be also a reversal, or because when you are using the language of disorientalism, is there a danger of a reversal which might be also inauthentic? So it is in that space, what is the challenge of mutual understanding in which either the oriental or the disoriental may miss the actual process of mutual understanding?
Thank you. A young woman, please.
Yes, hello. So I read an article recently by a Chinese writer who was saying that they've stopped thinking in Mandarin or Cantonese and are not thinking in English. And, you know, being multilingual, I was just curious as to how your brain, your creative brain, processes the fluidity of your actual tongue and how that translates into your creative work.
Well, I mean, those are really complicated questions, and I'm going to run through them. One was saying, asking about the whole business of lost in translation, and has anyone looked at the ways in which something has really changed? And I think you probably have been talking about this, that once your book is in the hands of somebody else, it takes on a life of its own anyway. But I wanted to pick up on this idea, do you stop being authentic when you're not writing in your own language? Or when something do you lose something of your own authenticity? And that was directed really at you, Kyoko.
I'm not sure about, I really don't know about myself as an authentic self. I think it includes the kind of person who wants to write in the language that she's not perfect in, for instance. But when it comes to writing, and what happens with my reader is that although, I mean, after all, it's fiction, it's made up, whether it's made of fake information of the Orient or whether it's made up of very correct information of the East, it's this fictional world, and I kind of half go there and put things around. And if the reader comes this way too and sees something and tells me about her experience of seeing something there, and I say like, wow, I didn't think about it. But that's not misunderstanding, I think. That's like a new understanding.
I mean, I was present this morning listening to the screenwriters and writers whose books have been turned into films and so on, and about the feeling of you know, the sort of change that the different genres make in making that transition. And one of the things that someone said was reminding us of the collaboration there is between the reader and the writer, and that readers may bring new things to your writing, things that you didn't even know were there. But that is part of the creative process, and that's part of the joy of the novel, that it lights up parts of a particular reader's experience, so they make these synapses, connections, and that's it's the intimacy of that project which makes them love you all as writers. So can I ask you all to join me in thanking this wonderful panel of writers and creators for what their participation is.